The wonders of aviation take to the skies on wings. Hit the sky in the Harrier, proven in combat to be an elusive target, a deadly weapon. With its stunning capacity for vertical flight, gravity seems not to exist. Defy the forces of man and nature. Great Plains, the AV-8.
Nowadays, we're so used to Harrier doing things that other aeroplanes can't that it's easy to forget what a long and difficult history jet vertical takeoff and landing has had. This thing, looking like something designed by Galileo, or even a creature from Tolkien's Middle Earth, was what Rolls-Royce called their thrust measurement rig, and what everybody else called the flying bedstead. That was 1953. It had two Rolls-Royce Neen turbojets mounted horizontally, but with their jets deflected vertically downwards. Two of these things completed 500 hovering flights. As did this wonderful Jules Verne machine, which came from the French Snecma stable in 1957. It called itself the Attard Volant, and it was just that, a great big Attard engine flying by dint of pushing itself into the air on a pillar of jet thrust. Now there were some really brave pilots. This was another Snecma effort, the Coléoptère. It was 2 years later than the Attard Volant, and it had developed from the idea of being a plane engine sitting on its thrust to having a big ducted fan at the back, or the bottom, depending on your point of view. This prototype crashed. Across the Atlantic, they were trying hard as well. This was the Doak VZ-4DA, a more or less conventionally shaped aeroplane with a big lifting fan, once again ducted, on each wingtip. At the same time, the Chrysler Corporation obviously decided that all that wing and fuselage stuff was excess baggage, and like the early French effort, they just had the basic engines. But now things began to look a bit more likely with either tilting engines or this Dornier DO31, which had a combination of lift engines, which did nothing else but provide lift, and engines with the new idea of vectored thrust. The Ryan company in the States avoided the waste of having separate lift engines by going for a tail sitter in this their VTOL test rig, which developed into the X-13, otherwise known as the VertiJet. Interestingly, the X-13 was powered by a British Rolls-Royce Avon engine. It had exhaust jet deflection to control pitch in the hover and air jets at the wingtips to control roll. It actually managed the very tricky manoeuvre of transitioning, which is the ugly word they use in vertical takeoff circles, transitioning from being supported by the thrust of the engine, with the aircraft pointing vertically upwards, engine-borne they call that, and being supported by the aerodynamic lift of the wings in normal flight, that's wing-borne. The VertiJet could even manage to transition back. But the problem is, just as it needed that rig to take off from, so it needs it to get back on the ground vertically. Imagine trying to do this highly complex capture maneuver in gusty wind conditions or in the heat of battle. Still, once you've done it, you fold it down and take it home on the back of the truck. A year behind the X-13 VertiJet was the Bell X-14. Now, this had two, once again British, Armstrong Siddeley Viper engines mounted side by side in the nose of the aircraft. The thrust of the engines was diverted downwards by a cascade vane system under the aircraft's centre of gravity. And pitch and roll were controlled by valves at the wingtips and the tail. To get to that stage, Bell had earlier gone through the phase of swivelling the whole engine instead of just the exhaust nozzles. In this 1954 aircraft, two small J-44 jets can point anywhere between horizontally backwards and vertically downwards. In 1958, Rolls-Royce were getting considerable support from the British government for their lift engine concept, and the flying bedstead had developed into the short SC-1. This achieved its first transition into wing-borne flight in 1960. It had five Rolls-Royce RB-108 engines. Four of them were mounted vertically in a central compartment to provide lift, and the fifth was positioned horizontally in the tail for forward propulsion. Control in the hover was achieved partly by swivelling the lift engines and partly by reaction control valves at the nose, tail and wingtips. Incidentally, this airframe still exists, and although its flying days are long over, you can still occasionally see its faintly comic bumblebee shape around the airshows. 5 years later, the French had a much sharper-looking ship in the shape of the Dassault Balzac, which also had a combination of separate engines for lift and cruise. However, there was only ever one prototype of this, and it was involved in two fatal crashes. Now, the thing about all the aeroplanes that we've seen in these flashbacks, and they cover three decades of intense development, is that not one of them ever got into operational service. Only two vertical takeoff and landing jet aircraft types have ever done that. One of them is a Soviet design, the Yak-36, NATO codename Forger. It's in squadron service with the Soviet Navy, it has a Vectored thrust main engine and two lift jets. And the other was perhaps the brainchild of the man who designed the classics of the Hawker stable, the Hurricane and the Hunter, Sir Sidney Cam. In the late 50s, Hawkers had failed to win the contract to build what eventually became the ill-fated TSR-2, and Cam directed his design staff towards the ideas of a Frenchman, Michel Vibo, for a single-engined vertical takeoff fighter called the Gyroptère. What eventually emerged was the P-1127. I said perhaps the brainchild of Sir Sidney Cam, because the more you look into this project, the more you realise that it's impossible to separate the aircraft from the engine, which in turn was the brainchild of Sir Stanley Hooker, technical director of the then Bristol Aero Engine Company. The wing of the P-1127 was mounted high to keep it clear of the jet exhausts. You couldn't stow any wheels in the wing, and a conventional tricycle undercarriage wouldn't fit in the sides of the fuselage because of the nozzles, hence the odd bicycle layout. The cockpit was simple, with conventional controls. There was just the addition of a simple nozzle control next to the throttle lever. On the 21st of October 1960, Hawker's chief test pilot, Bill Bedford, with one leg in plaster from a car accident, achieved the first hover with the aeroplane loosely tethered to the ground in case it should try and break away violently. The first trial showed that the mere 11,000 pounds of static thrust of this early Pegasus engine were not enough to provide both lift and full power for the reaction control system. That's the four puffers at the corners of the aeroplane which keep it stable. But within a month, Bill Bedford had mastered the hover sufficiently for the tethers to be removed. XP-831 hovered free. And soon the hovering became slow, jet-borne forward flight. The ease with which the 1127's envelope was explored vindicated Hawker's insistence on keeping the cockpit simple. And as the power of the Pegasus engine kept being uprated by Bristol, the envelope kept expanding. Before long, a second aircraft, XP-836, arrived on the scene. And whilst 831 continued jet-borne trials, 836 started working from the other end of the envelope in conventional wing-borne flight. On the 12th of September 1961, practical V-stall became a reality when XP-836 transitioned from hovering to conventional flight and back again.
Wings will return in a moment.
Who is this woman, and why do millions of men love her when they don't even know her name? Hello, I'm Bob Murphy, president of New Generation. This remarkable woman is Dr. Ilona Shrek-Parola, whose research on hair loss and baldness at the University of Helsinki led to the development of New Generation. 2 million orders have been sold in the last 8 years, but the best news of all is that we have a new product. Dr. Parola has given New Generation the rights to the formula she used in her research. It's true, New Generation has the exact formula developed by Dr. Parola at the University of Helsinki, and it's available to you right now.
I have given New Generation the rights to use the formula I developed.
We are extremely proud and excited to be able to offer you this formula. New Generation, not a drug, but a hair care system that helps unclog hair follicles so that your own hair can start growing again. With the addition of Dr. Parola's formula, New Generation's results can now be even better. Unfortunately, New Generation doesn't work for everyone. Use the New Generation hair care system for 90 days. If you get good results, great. If you don't, I'll give you your money back. So order New Generation now, because you've got nothing to lose. You have Dr. Parola's name on it.
Dr. Parola has given New Generation the right store exclusive formula. To order, call toll-free 1-800-624-3600. This complete system, if ordered individually, would be a $69 value. Call now and receive New Generation shampoo, conditioner, and the exclusive Dr. Parola overnight formula, all for only $49.95 plus $3 shipping and handling. Call toll-free 1-800-624-3600. That's 1-800-624-3600.
The technological revolution has touched every area of our lives. Join the race into the future. Leading Edge, Friday, 10:30 Eastern, 7:30 Pacific, only on the Discovery Channel.
And now, we return to Wings.
In 1962, the aeroplane was christened Kestrel after the bird that attacks creatures on the ground and hovers. And this bird became the mascot of an odd military unit that was set up by a three-nation consortium to test the operational feasibility of the Kestrel aeroplane. The Royal Air Force itself, a bit like the Royal Navy, was not particularly impressed with the operational capabilities of Vistol. But there had been a US-funded NATO group called the Mutual Weapons Development Program, which was prepared to put up some money to check out the ideas. Hence the formation of the tripartite squadron, staffed by officers from Germany, the US, and Britain. The squadron had 10 pilots and 9 aircraft, each with the specially designed three-nation insignia. After the pilots had been given some training on helicopters and fast jets, they all went to the Hawker Siddeley airfield at Dunsfold to be converted onto the Kestrel before the squadron was officially formed at Royal Air Force West Raynham in Norfolk on the 1st of April 1965. The start was not auspicious, because on that very day, a US Army pilot crashed the last Kestrel, which was only a month old. In fact, the Kestrel differed from the original 1127 in some important aspects. The straight trailing edge of the delta wing was changed to make it a truly swept wing, and the tailplane was given a distinct anhedral, or droop down, to improve stability, either upside down or the right way up. The reaction control system, those puffers at wingtip and nose and tail, were changed so that they could blow up as well as down, all of which improved maneuverability. Anyhow, in the 9 months that the tripartite squadron lasted, it clocked up 900-plus sorties and put the Kestrel well ahead of any other VSTOL program. But the RAF was still not interested because, like the Navy, it wanted a supersonic aircraft. This they were both due to get in two different versions of the P-1154, which Hawkers were designing as a supersonic development of Kestrel. Kestrel could only go supersonic in a dive. The 1154 was to be called Harrier, after the rather bigger hovering bird than the Kestrel. But in October 1964, the British government cancelled at a stroke three major aviation projects: TSR-2, a short takeoff transport, and the 1154 Harrier. The result was this, still called Harrier, but not the 1154. And not the Kestrel either. Although it was pretty much the same shape as Kestrel, it was a 90% new aeroplane. It had a bigger engine, 19,000 pounds of thrust, different intakes, an improved wing, and most importantly, a self-contained inertial navigation and weapons system with a head-up display for the pilot. In RAF terminology, it became the Harrier GR-1, GR for ground attack and reconnaissance. What eventually transpired was a compromise between the full-blown carrier and the helicopter cruiser. What the Navy fixed-wing people really liked was the drama of the steam catapult launching great heavy aircraft like the Sea Vixen, and particularly the Buccaneer, which was not known as the brick-built outhouse for nothing. By contrast, and for once in its life, the Harrier almost seemed to tiptoe off the deck. for landing back on, well, what could be more exciting than 10 tons of Sea Vixen or 15 tons of Buccaneer thudding onto the deck at 120 knots and being stopped in a few aircraft lengths? Even more of a contrast, then, when the Harrier stalks in like some great arched-backed cat and settles daintily onto its four paws. Of course, once those big carriers had gone and the Navy had no more fixed-wing aeroplanes to compare things with, the Harrier began to seem much more attractive. After all, the US Marines were using it, and so, surprisingly, was the Spanish Navy, which had bought 11 AV-8As and two of the two-seater TAV-8s. They were flying them from an old World War II carrier. The Spanish call their aircraft the Matador, Harrier being a bit tricky to pronounce in Spanish, and the carrier is an old US Second World War wooden deck ship, which they've renamed the Dedalo. So in 1975, the Royal Navy ordered a new version of the Harrier called the Sea Harrier FRS-1, standing for Fighter, Reconnaissance and Strike. The Navy was back into fixed wing. The FRS-1, as its designation suggests, was a multi-role aircraft, the word fighter denoting to the Navy at least air defence. The last time the Navy had bought an aircraft of its own for air defence, it had chosen the mighty F-4 Phantom. Defence requirement was the thing that provided the major difference between the Sea Harrier and other Harrier versions. Sea Harrier has a Ferranti Blue Fox air intercept radar in the nose with an autopilot flight control system. Another visual difference is caused by the pilot's seat being raised 11 inches higher than on the GR3, and that gives a better all-round view. But one thing that really improved the performance of the shipborne Harrier was an invention by Lieutenant Commander Doug Taylor for a university thesis in 1973, the ski jump, otherwise known as bending the front of the ship up. This is one of the through-deck cruisers, which are now called the Invincible class. Commander Taylor's idea had been tested out at the Royal Aircraft Establishment at Bedford. Basically, what the ski jump does is to convert a little of the aeroplane's forward rolling kinetic energy into vertical thrust so that the aircraft gets airborne at a slower speed. In short, you get a hefty punt in the underside just when you need it most. As an example of the kind of improvement you get in takeoff performance, a Harrier with a 10,000-pound load can take off at not much more than half the speed and using only a third of the deck roll that it would need on a flat deck. Also, it's safer because even if you have an engine failure at the critical moment, you're actually going upwards as you leave the ramp, and there's more time and height in which to eject. Altogether, the ski jump seems destined to take its place in the roll call of great British inventions for carrier operations, alongside the steam catapult, the angled deck, and the mirror landing site. Plus, of course, the Harrier. Sea Harrier can fight anywhere within its 400-mile radius of action from its ship. In its air defence role, its targets would be any aircraft threatening the fleet, and it would attack them with its four Sidewinder missiles, or in future, the AMRAAM, the Advanced Medium Range Air-to-Air Missile. It also carries two 30mm Aden cannon. With its sophisticated reconnaissance equipment, it can survey 20,000 square miles of sea in an hour's low-level flight. It can also carry the Sea Eagle anti-ship missile, as well as various other combinations of weaponry.
Wings will return in a moment.
For Post Natural Brand Flakes, Lena Horn on getting the best out of life.
Taking care of my voice, body, and taste buds is what keeps the brass in this horn.
Reach for the best tasting high fiber brand flake. Post Brand Flakes at their best.
If you could taste time, the sun, fresh air, if you could taste pride, dedication, this is what it would taste like. Smucker's Low Sugar Spreads. Half the sugar, only 8 calories per teaspoon. All the tradition.
Now there's a remarkable new product that turns ordinary tap water into clean, fresh-tasting drinking water in seconds. The new Brita water filter system. Simply pour ordinary tap water into the Brita pitcher. The patented filter removes the taste of chlorine and 90% of lead. The amazing Brita. Crisp, clean drinking water. Homemade.
Trying to tighten that tummy, struggling with ordinary sit-ups? Look, the Abdominizer targets the proper abdominal muscles, so each and every sit-up is made more effective, safer too.
I designed the Abdominizer to produce an automatic pelvic tilt, which better isolates the abdominal muscles and makes exercise safer for your lower back.
The unique rocker mechanism lets you rock. Rock. Rock your way to a firmer stomach. You can have a tonier tummy in weeks. Abdominizer cushions and cradles tailbone comfortably. It's doctor-developed to firm stomach faster. Tighten and tone upper and lower abdominals, plus lateral obliques to shape those love handles nobody loves. The Abdominizer, just $19.95. Call toll-free now. To order your Abdominizer, call 1-800-247-4500. That's 1-800-247-4500. Use your credit card to avoid COD charges or send check or money order for $19.95 plus $3 shipping and handling to Abdominizer, Department 630, Canton, Ohio, 44750. But for faster service, call 1-800-247-4500.
A house without locks. A train without wheels. And a wristwatch communicator. These are not gadgets out of a science fiction story, but inventions being perfected today. Open a window on the future and go beyond 2000. Every Thursday night at 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific.
And now, we return to Wings.
Here's a Marine's AV-8A preparing to take off vertically. See the front nozzle swing down there. In the cockpit, the controls are the same as in a normal single-engine jet fighter, except for the one extra control, the nozzle selector lever. If you push it fully forward, the nozzles go horizontal, for instance, a conventional rolling takeoff. Pull it back, and the nozzles swing down to the vertical for hovering flight, or vertical takeoff or landing. And of course, you can select any position between those two. The other, fatter lever is the throttle. You can also pull the nozzle selector right back through a gate, and the nozzles come down past the vertical to give you some reverse thrust. This is how it works in practice on a short takeoff, and we've now changed to an RAF GR1. The pilot calculates his liftoff speed, he accelerates to that speed with the nozzles horizontal, and he then puts them down to the optimum angle and lifts off. Let's see that again from the inside. The pilot sets his liftoff speed, in this case 90 knots, with a bug on the airspeed indicator. With the throttle closed, he sets a stop on the nozzle selector quadrant for the optimum angle, here 60 degrees. Now he's ready. With the nozzle selector fully forward, throttle to full power, as the airspeed hits 90 knots, nozzle selector back to the stop. The nozzles come down to 60 degrees, and you're flying, so far partly jet-borne. Move the nozzle slowly forwards to speed up and get more lift from the wings, and you're flying conventionally wingborne. That's the STO part of Stovall, the short takeoff. At the end of the flight would come a vertical landing. That is, unless there's a lot of debris about on, say, a damaged runway. In that case, you'd do a rolling landing so as not to blow the rubbish up ahead of you and suck it into the intakes. You could ruin a Harrier's day that way. But let's look at the vertical landing now. Here's the fighter pilot heading for his dispersed woodland landing site. About 1,000 metres out, he throttles back and brings the nozzle selector back through the gate to the reverse thrust position. The speed drops off quickly, and as he loses lift from the wings, he compensates by increasing engine power to give more jet-borne lift. As the aircraft comes to a stop, he brings the nozzles out of reverse thrust, and now he's in the hover using the throttle to control his height. When you're hovering, there's obviously no airflow over the control surfaces, so they don't work. But when you move the stick in the hover, you're working the Reaction Control System, RCS for short, otherwise more generally known as the puffers. You've got a pair in each wingtip. They blow up or down to give you control in roll. And there's one each in the nose and tail, which blow down only. They give you control in pitch. And there's another pair in the tail that blow left and right and give you control in yaw through the rudder pedals. So basically, all the controls work in pretty much the same way they do in conventional flight. And to achieve your smooth vertical landing from here, all you've got to do is keep the aeroplane straight and horizontal and adjust your height with the throttle. Easy, isn't it? In fact, it's probably easier than the rolling short landing, because here you've got to worry about getting the angle of approach right, whereas when you're coming down vertically, that doesn't apply. So the final lesson in our series, How to Fly the Harrier, is the vertical takeoff, which is simplicity itself. Just bring the nozzle selector back to the vertical position, pour on full power, and you have liftoff. Wheels up as soon as you like, start easing the nozzle selector forward, and before you know where you are, you're in conventional wing-borne flight. Piece of twaddle. Well, yes, but the job of most of the RAF's Harriers is in Europe, defending NATO countries against, for instance, a heavily armoured attack from Warsaw Pact land forces. The forward troops are taking some punishment here, which is not surprising when you bear in mind the numerical superiority of the Warsaw Pact ground forces. So anyway, after holding on as long as possible, the unit calls in air support. The quickest reaction time is almost certainly going to come from the Harriers, because they're based closer to the FIBA, as the army calls it, the forward edge of the battle area, closer than any other close support aircraft. Short takeoff rather than vertical to allow maximum uplift of weapons and fuel. as the aircraft dive towards the target, and incidentally, these are the now obsolete GR1 Harriers, the pilot sees the target ahead in his head-up display, and also his airspeed and altitude. The Sneb rockets fire, and the target is destroyed. There's just time for a quick victory roll before getting back to refuel and rearm. Something else the INS does is to allow you to navigate at high subsonic speed and at low level, which is one way the RAF chooses to avoid the attentions of the enemy's missiles. For reconnaissance, that's the R in GR3, you carry a recipod under the center fuselage. It contains five cameras, and each picture has printed on it the aircraft position, heading, speed, and altitude, courtesy of the INS. This Harrier, you may notice, doesn't have the GR3 nose, but it does have a pair of sidewinders on the outboard pylons under the wings. That makes it an AV-8A of the US Marine Corps. They also are pretty keen on refueling and rearming in the field. They learned about tactical operations the hard way in Vietnam. They've now come to the conclusion that the Harrier would have been highly effective there if they'd had it. These sidewinder air-to-air missiles are what they now use for self-defense, and these are firebombs, or napalm. Of course, being Marines, they fly on and off their own ships as well, although in this case note that they do not use the ski jump. One ability of the Harrier that the Marines can claim as all their own is something called VIFing, vectoring in forward flight. Here's an AV-8A being jumped by a simulated enemy. Now, because of its high wing loading, the Harrier is not all that agile compared with some fighters. Not, that is, unless you put the nozzles down as you turn. Then you really tighten up and leave the enemy wondering where you've gone.
Wings will return in a moment.
Catch Secrets of Nature, Wednesdays at 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific.
The finer things. Happily, some are affordable. Like Grey Poupon Dijon mustard. Grey Poupon has the classic quality of the original French Dijon recipe created centuries ago. A distinctively delicious taste for meats, salad dressings, and sauces. So enjoy one of life's finer pleasures.
Pardon, monsieur, est-ce que vous avez du Grey Poupon?
Mais bien sûr.
Grey Poupon, one of life's finer pleasures.
The most acclaimed nature documentary in the history of television is now available on video cassette. Witness nature in all its awesome power and deadly beauty. Time Life Video and WNET announce the Nature Video Library. A series so remarkable, the New York Times hails it as television at its most impressive. Your first video adventure takes you to Hawaii, islands of the fire goddess. Born in the conflict of fire and water, Hawaii is a land of amazing contrasts. A kaleidoscope of color,
a menacing land of sudden death. This is Hawaii, as few have seen it. Call now to receive Hawaii at the low introductory price of only $9.99 plus shipping and handling. Other exciting video cassettes will follow at only $19.99. Keep only those you want. Cancel at any time.
Credit card customers, call 1-800-435-0100 now to get your first video cassette, Hawaii, at the special introductory price of just $9.99. Or send 1322 to Nature, P.O. Box 1880, Department 1, Alexandria, Virginia. Or call now, 1-800-435-0100.
Every day, the Discovery Channel takes you on a global adventure. To help plan your journey, the Discovery Channel presents TDC, the monthly program guide that takes you to places like Japan, a culture rich in tradition and beauty. Meet the artists of a different breed on the streets of New York. Explore the wilds of Africa and witness the power of nature. TDC fine-tunes your viewing experience on the Discovery Channel. It keeps you informed and up to date on every minute of programming. Let TDC become your guide and receive 12 monthly issues for only $11.95. Call 1-800-TDC-8343. That's 1-800-TDC-8343. Your ticket to adventure.
If you could taste time, caring, dedication. If you could taste the sun, rain, fresh air. If you could taste tradition and pride. This is what it would taste like every time. With a name like Smucker's, it has to be.
And now, the conclusion of Wings.
The Falkland Islands are literally the other end of the world from Britain. There are no friendly bases from which land-based aircraft could operate. It was shipborne air support or nothing. And nowadays, without air support, you don't go to war. So, in the biggest naval mobilization Britain had seen since the Suez Crisis in 1956, the Harrier was amongst the most important items loading onto the ships of the task force at Portsmouth in early 1982. Here a Sea Harrier lands on the ill-fated Atlantic conveyor. The only good thing about the huge distances involved was that it gave them most of the length of the Atlantic Ocean in which to train. But it wasn't going to be enough. This was not a war for which they had prepared or trained.
Four.
And as they got closer to the expected conflict, the training got ever more realistic. They trained for attacks on surface shipping, and here the INAS really began to work for its living. Most of all, they trained for combat air patrols, the fleet's protective umbrella, until the training began to merge into the real thing. Training or for real, the maintenance below decks had to go on at an unprecedented rate. Suddenly, in the southern autumn of 1982, firing buttons were being uncovered for real. On May the 1st, a Navy Sea Harrier flown by an RAF exchange pilot, Flight Lieutenant Paul Barton, shot down an Argentine Mirage with a sidewinder. The Harrier was at war, and it was to destroy more than 20 Argentine jets. 9 Harriers were downed, none by Argentine aircraft. Some of the RAF GR3s had flown all the way to the war zone via Ascension Island. Between Britain and Ascension alone, they had to refuel in the air 5 times using Victor tankers. But to the Argentines occupying Port Stanley, they just seemed to keep on coming. Sometimes the Argentines managed to shoot one down with ground fire. Out to sea, the fleet was putting out picket vessels to give itself advance warning of attack. The main danger was from the French-built Super Etendard with its Exocet sea-skimming missiles. One of the lessons learnt, or perhaps relearnt, from Operation Corporate was that air support is essential in any modern war, no matter how far from home you are, and if you don't have big carriers, that has to be from V-Stol aircraft. British Aerospace even developed a system for operating Harrier off frigates. Harrier has historically needed a ship the size of a cruiser because the smaller ship just doesn't have sufficient deck space. The British Aerospace system was called Skyhook. It was a special crane with stabilization that cancelled out the ship's motion. All the pilot had to do was get the aircraft into the right area using a special homing sight. The crane head locked onto the aircraft automatically, the pilot throttled back, and the aircraft was drawn up against a special cradle. It could be refueled right there in the cradle, but if you wanted to rearm it or change the pilot, you had to swing it onto the deck. When the pilot was ready to take off, he increased power until the aircraft was hovering, let go, and flew off. Well, that was perhaps an idea for the future that so far hasn't come to anything. This aeroplane is the future any time now. It's the Harrier GR5 in formation with two GR3s. The thing is, it may be a Harrier, in fact the new family is called Harrier 2, Roman 2 that is, but it's the product of a joint effort by McDonnell Douglas and British Aerospace. It's actually the McDonnell Douglas AV-8B Harrier 2. Despite 30 years of successful British operational VTOL aircraft, there's not been enough support this side of the Atlantic for British Aerospace to continue to be the sole contractor for this unique family of aeroplanes. On the other hand, the US Marines' unflinching support of the Harrier principle has meant that the US contractor, which has been involved with much of the stateside development of the Harrier, McDonnell Douglas, is now even further involved. This is a brand new and very impressive aircraft. In the interests of reducing weight while increasing strength, it contains more carbon fiber composites they call them in the States, than any other military aircraft. It's got a much bigger wing than earlier Harriers. You can see that the wing continues beyond the outrigger undercarriage legs, which quite changes the appearance. And you can see here the huge array of military weaponry it can carry, from air-to-air missiles through rockets and iron bombs to smart laser-guided weapons. Its combat radius of action is improved to nearly 700 miles, and its external stores load to 9,200 pounds over shorter distances. Part of these improvements are accounted for by the 23,000 pounds thrust Rolls-Royce Pegasus 105. So that's the near future for the outstandingly successful Harrier family. Early on in this century, the great inventor Thomas Edison said, "The airplane won't amount to a damn until they get a machine that will act like a hummingbird. Go straight up, go forward, go backward, come straight down, and alight like a hummingbird. It isn't easy, somebody is going to do it." They did.
Coming up next week on Wings. Witness the birth of a legend. From its conception through its career, it was the most superior bomber of its time. Great Plains, the B-17.
A little piece of paradise beckons in one of Sweden's parks. Stay tuned for Secrets of Nature. Then at 11 Eastern, the war is over, but the trauma continues for the forgotten people in Southeast Asia Revisited.